Hello viewer, welcome to Artistry. My name is Tirus Wanyoike, and this is the woodwork department. So today we have quite a number of tools and equipment around us, and many of them we had introduced last time or as we progress, but just to remind us, we have to keep reminding ourselves what each tool does and what is the proper name for it. So on my bench, I have quite a number of tools, and starting right from my left, which is your right, we have a tool that we call the chisel. So this is a bevel edge chisel that is used together with the mallet. So the mallet and the chisel are good friends. They work together, and we don't hit the chisel with the hammer. The hammer is meant for the nails and other metal surfaces like the nails and the like. So these two are used especially in joinery, where we are making joints. And so whenever we shall be making joints and we want to cut a piece in a wood, we have to use the chisel and the mallet. So the chisel has a sharp edge, and the sharp edge has to be kept sharp. So we have the sharpening stone that is used for that purpose, and we only sharpen the chisel one side. We look at it carefully. It has three bevels, this one, and another one here. So these two, we don't sharpen them. The bevel on the front part is what we sharpen with the sharpening stone. And then after it is sharp, it can easily cut and efficiently cut. So this is a 22 millimeter chisel. So we measure from end to end along the width. Here, this should be 22 millimeters. So we define the chisel by its width. So we have smaller chisels, we have wider chisels, we have many types of chisels, but for all chisels, we use the mallet to drive the chisel into the wood. And periodically, we may need to use the chisel without a mallet. That process, we call it paring. Paring is the process of using the chisel without using the mallet. So we drive it, we curve it and drive and get the shape that we want. So in order to get a smooth and a good joint, we use the chisel sometimes without the mallet, a process that we call paring. So the mallet, we have introduced it. It's a percussion tool. Remember we said percussion is driving of a tool in the manner of hitting. So as we hit, the tool will work for you. So the chisel and the mallet go together. So now we have a very common tool that we have in our homes. This tool, many of us just know it as the hammer. But hammers are different in sizes, in shapes, and in purposes. So this particular hammer is known as the claw hammer. And simply, the claw is this bit here, which is used to pluck nails out. So this is a claw that gives this name, the claw hammer. Of course, the hammer is the hitting part of it. So if it has a claw, then the whole of it is a claw hammer. So it's used for joinery and also carpentry. So as we hit the nails, we use it as a percussion tool as well. So it will be used to drive in nails and also to pluck them out. But if you are doing heavy duty work, then you may need to use a metallic handle instead of the wooden one. The wooden one is very good in hitting. When you're hitting the nail, it's much more comfortable, convenient, and all this. But if you're plucking a nail out, especially a long nail, then you may have to use a handle with a metal fitted handle. So the hammer, the claw hammer, is also a part of the items that we use in carpentry and joinery. Then from there, I have about three power tools. Power means it has a motor inside it, and then it has a means of powering, which for this case, this one is a battery cordless drill or a screwer. They can screw, they can drill. So the screwer comes in different sizes, comes in different colors as well, but the purposes, they are the same. It is used for either drilling or screwing, depending on the bit that you will fit in the front part of it here. So it's important to know the right use of this power tool, because many of us may have it in our homes. Many of us may just desire it when you see it being used, and then you desire it, you go to the shop and buy it. Now, if you don't have the right skill in using it, you may either kill it, or it might take a short time than it is supposed to take. So the machine has several functions. Right, starting from the top here, this is a Makita brand. It's a Makita brand. So the brand may vary, and the controls as well may be located differently, but they may not be very different from each other. But now the location of the function, the switches and the controls may differ from one machine to the other, depending on the company. Now, for this particular one, it's a Makita brand. Makita is a good brand. We have used it for some time, and it is working well, except the cover that is almost coming out, but it is still on. You can still use it. It's for convenience and for comfort that it is fitted with a silicone cover, the black one, so that it can be hand friendly. Now, on top of this Makita machine, we have a control here. You can either take it here, it is written 1, and here 2. So the switch can move from 1 to 2, from 2 to 1. So it is used to control the torque of the machine. So as the machine drills, then if you are drilling, you may require to use more speed and less power. The power to turn it, you may require more speed and less power. So you use gear number 2 to drill. And also when you are screwing, especially long screws and any kind of screwing, then you use number 1, where you don't need a lot of speed, but you need some more power. So that control is very important. If you don't know about it, then you may find that the machine is too slow when you are drilling. It might not give you the required results. So it's important to know how to control that switch. You either ensure it is in number 1 or 2. If you strain it too much in number 2, then you are reducing the lifetime of this machine. So this is one very important control. The other one is here. I may remove the cover a little bit for us to see it well. We have this button here, which you may either press that side, or from this other side, now again, you can press this side. So from there, you can see the two controls, either that way or this way. There is an arrow here. The arrow indicates the direction. So the one that indicates front, it will turn clockwise. It will turn the chuck. This part we call it the chuck. So the chuck will turn clockwise when we put it in that position. So it will turn clockwise once we start drilling or screwing. If we turn the opposite side, then it will turn anti-clockwise, which is opening. So we can either screw or unscrew using this machine. We can drill, and then as we remove the drill bit, we have to reverse it because the drill bit has threads. Now, that is another control. At the center, the switch will not go in, so it will not rotate. And when you are storing or keeping the machine, it's good to keep it at the center so that when you put it and anything hits or presses the power button, then it will not rotate as you keep it. You may keep it in the box and then you have some sound at after some time in the box, and then you may be wondering, who is that or what is happening? You may think these are supernatural forces that are working in your box. It might just be something that is pressing against the switch of your power battery screw. So it's important to to put it either, not either, even at the center as you store it. Then when you are using it, you either choose the front or the reverse part of it. So that is a very important control. The other one is the switch itself. The switch itself will have also some adjustments that you can do. As you drill, once you press the switch just a little bit, the machine will move very slowly. It will move slowly, slowly, slowly. As you press more and more and more, then it increases. It will increase with pressing. So it's important to know how to regulate this machine for you to get maximum output out of it, and also a long lifetime. Then we also have a battery. The battery can be removed because it will discharge as it continues to work. Then when it is almost flat, it is not moving, it is not working for you, you remove it. We have a battery charger here. The battery charger will blink green if it is not charging. It will blink green. Then I'll fit my battery here, that slot, and then it will turn red. So red indicates that it is charging. And once it is full, it will indicate green, the same light. So for this Makita brand, those are the colors that are denoting different stages of the battery position. And in case once you put the battery, it still blinks, then it might be having a problem. There might be some something wrong with the battery itself. But if the blinking is when the battery is not on, then that is normal. That is expected. So now it is charging as we talk. So when you are not using the battery screwer, put it there, and then it will charge. And from there, once it is full, now it had charge, so we don't have to charge it to be full. It had charge, so we can still insert it here. It has some clip, so it will clip once we press it a little bit, and then we continue working. Now, from there are some calibrations here that are denoting something. Look at this part here. It is written 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all the way up to 14, and then some two dashes, and then something like a drilling bit there. So this one controls the torque of the machine. The torque of the machine, that means the machine will stop at some point. It will stop rotating. Although the motor is still on, it will not rotate. The part that is protruding here, especially when you are screwing, it will not rotate, but the motor is still on. So it is used to avoid overscrewing. If you overscrew, then you destroy your work. So a little resistance here will stop the chuck from rotating. So that means you can control the work you are doing using the torque control here. Then if you don't need the torque control mechanism, you want to go full force, then you put it here where there is a drilling bit indicating. Then this way now it is not torque regulated. To go, to move, to either overscrew or just tighten very fast. So the machine is quite strong, the way it is made. It will give you very good grip on the screw, depending on the fixture that you have fixed here. Then you have your work very fast and well done. So this is a very important tool, especially in the home or in the vehicle when you're traveling. Then you may require to have such power tools, because they don't need any extra power to be connected to a power source. Once you have a battery and it is applied in two, so there are two batteries, and then there is a charger. Once you charge them from home, then they can take a whole day before the battery is drained. So that is the power screwer, the battery screwer. we have another machine here. that we call the hammer drill. The hammer drill is a power tool to be connected to the mains, to the power, then it will rotate. Now, unlike the battery screw, this one now will not work until it's connected to the power source. So it will need to be connected to the power source. It is used for heavy duty purposes. And then we will have to see its functions in a short while. So for now, we'll go for a break. And then once we come back, we'll be able to see the various controls and functions of the power drill. So stay tuned.